Yes, welcome back to the set. Now we've unveiled the people who are speaking with us, experts in their own field. I'll start by introducing Paul. I give him the option of telling me what his surname is, so you know we didn't plan this. Paul.
I'm Paul Owanibay.
Hi, Paul.
How are you?
But I do know you're an architect. I do know you're the managing director of a landmark, that beautiful piece of business that lies right there by the sea in Victoria Island. Welcome to Seriously Speaking.
Thank you very much. My pleasure.
And of course, my sister, you know, I call her Hetty, but to you, she's Dr. Henrietta, right? Or you call her Dr. H.
Yes, Dr. H.
It's nice to have you on set.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
She's somebody that's so passionate about Nigerian development and Nigerian entrepreneurs and what they can do. So I had to invite her to be part of this conversation.
Thank you.
But let me start with Paul. Paul, you used to live in the UK. For how long did you live there?
Gosh, all my life.
Wow.
I was one of those fortunate or unfortunate people. I was born in the UK, but my parents sent me to boarding school in Nigeria at the age of 10.
And you hated it?
I hated it initially, but I loved it after. Came back and then the rest, as I say, is history.
Yeah, you came back, but you went back to the UK to work, to do what?
I went back to the UK to finish my education. I did a master's there and then I worked there for some time. I worked in an architectural practice and I worked in a property development practice. And I worked with Regis, the serviced office provider.
So why did you come home to set up Landmark?
Gosh, it's a long story.
Give me the shorter version, because I know you followed her on her trip. So she must have thought your story could resonate with people in diaspora.
I did. So unlike many people, I think the world is becoming a global village. And very much so, I think the advantage is everywhere you want to be. And, you know, we talk about imports and exports. Nigeria exporting some of its best citizens is an export. But it only yields fruit when they come back home. So my feeling was, you know, when you come to a place like Nigeria and you know, Africa generally, I mean, there's so many opportunities because so many things haven't been done. And I said on the last time I spoke, if you want to be successful, find out where the people are going and get there first. As I don't know, real estate is all about that. But I think many industries are all about that. So that's what I did. I decided to.
But there must have been challenges, though. You can't tell me it was a smooth sail.
No, absolutely.
Deciding to come back here.
No, there are challenges all over the world, and you've got to decide what those challenges are and how you tackle those challenges. And I heard someone say earlier, every challenge is an opportunity. So the challenges are huge because this place is very different from that place.
Mm-hmm.
But there are many opportunities here that don't exist there. Mm-hmm. And, you know, for once in your life, when you do come home, is that you can stare people in the face and you will be taken on the basis of who you are. Yes, and what you know and what you can do, as opposed to what
you're
color
black,
you are.
You're white.
Oh, yes, absolutely.
That sounds interesting. But, you know, so people like Henrietta, you say Nigeria is virgin land still till today, right?
Huge opportunities, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So as an investment potential, you were giving me an example of something that happened to potatoes in Nigeria recently.
Oh, yes. So in spite of the fact that potatoes grow here in abundance, most fast food outlets were importing potatoes. But then in 2016, with the economic crisis, they couldn't get the foreign exchange to import potatoes. And so they had to turn to local alternatives. And so Nigeria saved $62.8 billion. None of those outlets closed down. They simply...
We didn't even know because it looked the same.
Absolutely, absolutely. Because it's even better here because they're organic, 100% organic. And they were wasting. They say in just, for instance, they have potatoes in such abundance that it's easier for them to leave them to rot when they bring them out to sell in the market than to take them back home in the evening. And yet we're importing these potatoes. And the other huge opportunities, Nigeria is said to have the best peanuts in the world, but we don't export peanuts, mainly because of our packaging technique. And this happens to a lot of our products. Our shea butter is in demand the world over. But then if we don't package it well, we can't exploit the full economic potential.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Same thing with indigenous fashions. African fashions are the rave right now abroad. But then we have beautiful pieces made here, but not scaled. So there are huge opportunities here that we haven't fully exploited. So mm-hmm. anybody who comes here and sets up a tailoring academy, for instance, will easily scale a production unit which can export things like what we're wearing now mm-hmm. to neighboring African countries, Europe, and
even
America.
Even if Africa is our immediate market, that's big enough.
Oh, exactly.
I mean, even Nigeria.
Even mm-hmm. in Nigeria. So, for instance, if you wanted this piece in size 12, 14, 16, 24, you won't find it. So the person who made it just makes one or two at most.
Okay, but I think I'll bring Udo in at this point in time. Mm-hmm. While these opportunities exist, doing business in Nigeria doesn't still remain difficult. And didn't you have people asking you such questions when you were away?
Well, absolutely. I mean, and, you know, doing business in Nigeria is very difficult, and that's why we were very low on the on the index, you know, as far as ease of doing business, you know, in the world. Good news, though, is that in the last, you know, few weeks, we've gone up about 24 points.
What's
up.
Responsible for that, though?
The vice president and his team are doing a great job of trying to improve ease of doing business, and they continue to do things. So we're working.
That would include registration of companies.
Absolutely.
This kind of tax.
Absolutely, reducing the multiplicity of taxes.
How you get visas. Mm-hmm.
How you get all those things. Yeah. So we're working on it. We're gradually becoming an easier place to invest. Yeah.
So those questions, how did you answer them?
By giving them the facts. I mean, one of the things we wanted to do by taking Nigeria to the world was to actually provide people accurate information. Because most times people don't invest because they lack good quality information. We also wanted to give them current insight. Mm-hmm. So we actually had Business Day, a publisher there, and His Excellency Mr. Peter Obi, who basically talked about the economy and what's going on. And so we gave them the real facts, mm-hmm. but also showed them what the challenges were. Because, I mean...
You didn't hide anything.
We didn't hide anything,
So, I mean,
yes.
how effective do you think that kind of sales are? And do you think this directing our communication about investment opportunities to the Nigerians in diaspora is a good strategy?
I think, absolutely. There are three things...
But that's just that's a stupid question.
Absolutely. But I think there are three things I think we've got to do as a set of people. So just take to headline news. There's between $20 and $30 billion that comes in from the diaspora every year. So it's coming in anyway, yes?
Where is it going?
Exactly.
People
like that's exactly the point.
They're buying homes.
All you need to do is look at where it's going, and the government needs to mirror that and make those sectors easier. And I'll say to you that probably 80% of that money is going into three sectors. People, health, when people are sick, they send money home. Oh, education, wow. when they want to train their relatives. Mm-hmm. And property, when they want to buy things. Those are the three things that 80% of this money is going to. Now, if we want to be successful...
Are you listening? Health, education, and property. So if I had a business in health, set up a hospital, for example.
Yes, absolutely. And that's a huge opportunity in the economy.
A massive opportunity. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And a lot of the Nigerians in diaspora are professionals. So they got themselves educated. So whether it was engineering or health or property related or humanities or arts related, they can come back and play in these three areas and many other areas, by the way. The
and
other 20% is still quite big. So what we do need to do is try to find a platform where an organized platform where the diaspora can pool their resources easily. And I think what Nigeria doesn't lend itself to properly at this point in time, and that's probably because of the ease of doing business, which I'm delighted to hear it's going
it's
up,
improving.
Is allow the diaspora who are a lot more organized in terms of how they think about sending in money and the sort of returns they're looking for. But they're not as ambitious as the local Nigerians in terms of returns as well. So we provide the platform, and I think very easily you see more of that money coming in a
more organized way. What do you think about that kind of platform? Who should be setting it up, government or the private sector, or both?
I think both of us. I think that public-private partnerships work perfectly. So, for instance, I've set up what we call the Entrepreneurship Impact Center under the Pan-Atlantic University, under the Entrepreneurship Development Center. And the whole idea of this center is to generate profitable business opportunities aimed at transforming society.
So, is that what you call social entrepreneurship kind of thing?
Well, I would say more of impact investing, which means for profit with a social purpose.
Okay.
So it's real business. And what people don't understand that is that the biggest secret of richest people in the world is that they are solving problems. So Jack Ma will say to you, for instance, if you want to remain small, solve small problems. If you want to be really big and really wealthy, solve big problems. Because a problem means people are looking for a solution, and so they will patronize you. Mm-hmm. So if few people need your solution, few people will patronize you. If a lot of people need your solution, a lot of people will patronize you. Why is Bill Gates the richest man in the world? There's almost no country in the world you go to where you don't find the Microsoft operating system being used. So he's provided a global solution.
You can't run from him.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So everybody needs him. And that's why he will always continue being very wealthy. Why is Dangote the wealthiest man in Africa? Because Africa is a developing continent. We all need cement. I mean, he's got into food, clothing, and shelter, things that are recession-proof. Hmm. You know, so people need to...
I should get out of this top business.
So people need to go back to the basics and understand that entrepreneurship is about creating value that is relevant.